never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Ooh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean, so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now.
Let's sing about y'all.
You are a Jireh. You are enough.
So clear what it's all about.
So stay by my side when the sun goes down. Don't wanna forget how I feel right now.
Jireh,
Jireh, you are enough.
I know that you are.
Jireh,
you are
enough.
I will be
Oh, Praise the Lord, everyone, and welcome to New Generation Youth Ministry. My name is Pastor Curtis, and I have the privilege of serving as pastor of youth here at Rhema Christian Center. I hope and pray that everything is great with you and that you're navigating these times well. Well, get ready and grab your Bibles because we're getting ready to journey into God's Word in order to reach the lost, train for service, and change our world for Jesus Christ. Let's jump into the lesson and see what God has to say for us today. Well, praise the Lord, everyone, and welcome to our session today. I want to say hello to all of New Gen out there. I hope you guys are doing well, navigating school and everything else. I hope that your families are safe and that you're still navigating all this crazy. But hey, the weather's getting better, and I just can't wait to see you all when we start having in-person service on a regular basis. Well, thank you for joining me today, because now we're going to be finishing up our series on developing multidimensional leaders, number 6. And we've been talking about being a relatable, or being a leader that's all about relationships. Our model for this study has been the person of Jesus Christ. So before we jump into all of that today, let's acknowledge God's word, and let's pray, and then jump into our lesson today. If you got your Bibles with you, whatever it is you're using for your Bible, then hold it up and repeat after me. This is my Bible. There are many like it, but this one is mine. With it, I have purpose. With it, I find my destiny. With it, I know who God is. More importantly, I know who God is not. With this word, I can see the invisible. I can touch the intangible. I can do the impossible. With this word in my life, I can change the world without the world taking Jesus away from me. Oh Lord, put this word in my heart that I may walk it out in my life by the power of the blood and the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. Again, we're going to be, turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 7, verse 28. Matthew 7, verse 28. That's kind of been our focus verse for this journey that we've been on, looking at multidimensional leaders. And I'm also going to have you turn to Mark chapter 2, verse 14. And those will be our reference scriptures. And I'm going to give you a couple of more, but those are the first two I want you to turn to. We've been talking about multidimensional leaders. We've been talking about leaders, and we've been talking about leadership is influence, okay? But I believe that leadership is more than just influence, because someone can hold a gun at you and influence you. Someone holds a gun up to you and say, hey, kiss my feet. You might sit there and go, hey, I'm not gonna do that. I ain't gonna do that. Well, I think if it's, you know, at the cost of your life, you're going to go ahead and do that. Did that person influence you? Yes, but how did they do it? Through domination, through intimidation, through fear. We've been talking about, you know, godly leaders. And godly leaders, first of all, you know, Christian leaders are leaders who put Jesus Christ first. They're great followers of Christ. We talked about that. And we talked about the different dimensions that leaders are in. It's not just about being in charge. It's not just about being over people. But one of the aspects of being a multidimensional leader, a leader not only needs to be able to be in charge, yes, to be able to navigate with people, yes, but in leadership, a leader also needs to have good, healthy relationships with people. So we've been talking about relating in a very healthy way with people, and having healthy relations with your community, with people, and et cetera. So what we're gonna talk about today is relationships. Being a multidimensional leader when it comes to relationships, but we're going to look at how Jesus related to people who were in need, whether that need was a physical need, whether it was a medical need, whether it was an emotional need. We're going to talk about how Jesus related to people in need. There's two questions we've been asking ourselves while we've been doing this lesson, and that is, why did people relate to Jesus? You know, and why was Jesus so attractive to people? Why did people like him? He had charisma. What drew people to him? You know, you guys are teen men and teen women, so you guys navigate through all of this when it comes to relating to people. How do you guys relate to people? How are your relationships with people? Whether it's your parents, whether it's family, whether it's folks in the community, whether it's your peers, whether it's online, how do you relate to people? How do you connect to people? Are people attracted to you? In the sense, I ain't talking about trying to get your phone number and get with you, but I'm talking about, how are people drawn to you? You know, are people drawn to you? Okay. How do you relate to other people? And how do you relate being a Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ? How do you relate that to other people? Well, let me read this verse from the Sermon on the Mount. And this is out of Matthew chapter 7, verse 28. And then we're going to pray and just get into our lesson today. The Bible says, and it came to pass when Jesus had ended these sayings, and that is when he finished preaching a famous Sermon on the Mountain, the people were astonished at his doctrine. They were just amazed. And for he taught them as having authority, but not as the scribes. Okay, he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to navigate through your word today. Lord, I ask you to bless every teen man and teen woman in the sound of my voice. Lord, I pray that you would bless them as we navigate through your word, that we might be stronger followers of you, O Jesus. Lord, I pray that your word would just settle in our hearts, that we may walk it out in our lives. And Father, I pray that this word is able to make an impact so that we can reach the lost, train for service, and change our world. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. All right, let's take a look. When we look at the Sermon on the Mountain, which is, you know, one of the, I think it's the best sermon ever given. And there's even people who weren't listed as Christians, someone like Gandhi, who said it was the greatest sermon ever given. It's interesting because when we look at the Sermon on the Mountain, we ask questions like, what did Jesus talk about? You know, and then how did Jesus connect with people? Because this sermon really connected him with the community. And the Bible says that they were astonished. They were amazed at what he was saying because he spoke as authority, but not as one of the scribes. Scribes were people who were in the religious community. Their responsibility was to document scripture. And they were very meticulous. They were very religious. They were very dedicated to what it is that they're doing. But they also seemed to have an attitude of being a little bit better than the people around them. And people could not connect or relate to them. And that's real important as it comes to us being Christians, how we connect and relate to others. You know, some people used to say, you're so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. I used to hear people say that. I don't know if I agree with that saying, because I don't know if you're really heavenly minded. You know, if you're too arrogant or too stuffy or too whatever to relate to people, I don't know if you're heavenly minded or you just you minded. You know, we should never take Jesus to the point of where we can't relate him to others, that we can't relate the message, his message to the people around us. We should, if anything, the closer we get to God through the person of Jesus Christ, the more humble it should make us. It should make us more humble. It should give us humility. It should make us more gentle and kind towards others so that we can relate the message that God has for the world related to everybody. And Jesus was that kind of person. You know, when we ask questions on the Sermon on the Mount, what did he talk about? We've been going through that. So if you haven't seen the other messages, go back and watch the other ones. You know, but what did he talk about? You know, how did he, again, connect with the people? Well, the Sermon on the Mountain, it actually offered guidelines to the kingdom of God. He actually explained them, you know, the kingdom of God in such a way that people were able to connect with it. So he talked about obeying the letter of the law of God's word, but he also talked about the conforming, that is being pressed into the mold of transforming, and so that we would honor the spirit of what God was saying, okay? So that's like me saying, stay out of my office. You know, if you're at church, stay out of my office, which y'all know I have an open door policy. So the letter of the law is stay out of my office. Now, if you saw me fainted in the office, like I'm out, I'm laying in my chair, something wrong, and you're just standing there going, well, he said not to come into his office, and so I guess we should call somebody because he said not to go into his office. Come on, y'all. Now, you understand the letter of what I said and the spirit of what it is that I'm saying. Jesus was like, look, let's obey the letter of the law, but let's understand the spirit. Be transformed in your mindset to understand the spirit of what God is actually saying. So this message challenged popular beliefs in that time, behaviors in that time, and things that people practiced during that time. And not only did it challenge it then, it challenges us now on the things we believe, how we behave, how we practice and do life. So let's take a look at the Sermon on the Mount. And there's three principles I want to bring out of that today. And that is, when it comes to relating to people in need, you know, Jesus, his message on his message was always a message that asked people to follow him. He was always inclusive. So when we look at the Sermon on the Mount, when we look at, you know, what he was really trying to say, how people were astonished, how people were drawn to him, how people were pulled towards him, Jesus always had room for people in his life. And he always, you know, connected with people and asked them to follow him and be a part of what he was doing, or have him be a part of their lives. In Mark chapter 2, verse 14, I'm reading in the New Living Translation. The Bible says, as he walked along, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at his tax collector's booth. Follow me and be my disciple, Jesus said to him. So Levi got up and followed him. Now, one of the ways, that reasons why Levi, who we know as Matthew, which is, by the way, my middle name, he was a Levite and he was a tax collector. And you got to understand, in Jewish culture, they hated tax collectors. They just hated them. You know, these were the people who collected taxes not only for, you know, the king, the Jewish, you know, rulers, leadership and rulership and government, but also was collecting taxes for Rome. So they really didn't like, you know, they really didn't like tax collectors. So here was, you know, Matthew or Levi, who you might even refer to as a young hustler. And so he's like, every day I'm hustling, and he getting money from his own people. So you could tell, you could see he was an outcast. People didn't really like him. But Jesus came to him and said, man, come follow me. And so I think that Matthew or Levi was attracted to Jesus because he was asked. He asked him. He reached out to him in a time of need, of him being emotionally disconnected from everyone, his people. And Jesus said, hey, why don't you come follow me? Why don't you come join me? And he was more than happy to be involved. And Jesus always invited participation. And that's one of the things I love about Jesus, is that he was very inclusive. And I think, guys, as Christians, we need to learn how to be more inclusive versus being exclusive. Exclusive is when you try to do things to keep people out. Inclusive is when you try to do things to help people get in. Don't get me wrong, there are certain criteria that should take place. You don't just get to walk into the, for example, you don't just get to walk into a movie theater. You know, you got to have a ticket of some kind, a pass of some kind, a coupon of some time, some kind, or money of some kind. But everyone can go to the movie theater if you wish to go. Okay. Nowadays, you know, wearing a mask and all the other stuff. But what I'm saying is, they're not going to say, hey, you're female. Hey, you're male. Hey, you're black. Hey, you're white. Hey, you're whatever, and you can't go in. Do you speak three languages? You know, that would be exclusive. What can we do to keep people out? But inclusive says, hey, everyone's invited. Come on in. So Jesus always invited participation. You know, now sometimes it might be at a cost. He might say, he told a rich young ruler one time, sell all of your worldly goods, give the money to the poor, and come follow me. So sometimes there might be a caveat, but Jesus would invite people to join him. Hey, come follow me. Hey, be a part of what was going on. And I love the fact that Jesus reached out to people in need, and Matthew was in an emotional need. He encouraged people to follow him. He reached out and said, hey, why don't you come follow me? See, asking people to join us in worship, asking people to join us to learn about Jesus, asking people to even come to church. Now, I know there's been a change in the last year because of COVID, but asking people to join us is really the easiest thing to do. It's the cheapest thing to do, too. It doesn't really cost you any money, you know, and it's the most important thing that we don't do. It's something that we should do, but we really don't do. Okay. And it's not about, you know, just asking people, hey, would you join us in worship? You know, would you join me in, you know, why don't you come to church with me or something? It's easy to do. 80% of the people, and this is from the Pew Report with Tom Rainer, 80% of the people who come over the bridge from the world to the church actually came because they were asked. That's interesting. 80%, that means 8 out of 10 people who ended up, you know, being in church or who joined the church or became disciples of Jesus Christ originally got involved and became invested because somebody asked them, Hey, why don't you come to church with me? Hey, why don't you join a Bible study with me? Hey, you know, we're getting ready to go, you know, to maybe a concert or something. Would you like to come with me? So again, 8 out of 10 people, 80% if someone just asked them. So Jesus was all about asking people to follow him, asking, you know, them to be involved in his life. You know, that's what helped Jesus relate to others in need. Here's a young tax collector. His own people don't like him. Jesus reached out to him and said, hey, why don't you follow me? Another thing I want to talk about, number two, is that Jesus made room for different types of people. So not only did he reach out to people who were in need, he reached out to different kinds of people. In Mark chapter 2, verse 15, the next verse after that, it said, and it came to pass that as Jesus sat at meat in his house, many publicans and sinners sat also together with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many, and they ended up following him. They followed him specifically, but they ended up following him. Now, publicans were tax collectors. Again, I told you, they, you know, people who, you know, they didn't like them. Tax collectors, y'all taking money from us. Y'all are thieves. You're traitors to your own people. But, you know, sinners were there, and these were people who were living outside the will of God, but they were attracted to him because he made space for them in his life. You know, when people make space for you, when people make room for you, have you ever felt like you were outcast? Maybe you feel like you were outcast at school, or maybe outcast online. Maybe you're outcast, you know, in your own community or neighborhood or family or whatever, and someone made room for you. You know, someone made space for you. See, sometimes people get caught up with the wrong group. They get caught up with the wrong crowd, because guess what? Even though that's a group you shouldn't be hanging around with, that's the group you shouldn't be following, but they made room for you. They made a space for you. How much more we as followers of Jesus Christ, guys, should make space for people in our lives, okay? And just use wisdom when it comes to making space. But Jesus made space, you know. He made room for different kinds of people. These were sinners. He was sitting there having meals with them. These were tax collectors, which people hated. And the Bible says, you know, and there were many, and they followed him, you know. So tax collectors and sinners saw that they were welcome. You know, it's one thing to make room. It's another thing to make someone feel welcome. Have you ever gone somewhere, and even though they might have made a space for you, you really didn't feel welcome? I have. I've been there before. I've been in those kind of situations where, well, good afternoon to you too. I'm like, what? Sadly to say, I've even gone to some churches where you're not even made to feel welcome. That's always a bad thing. We as Christians, especially when we're, we as Christians, let me just say it that way, but especially in the house of the Lord, we should go out of our way to make everyone feel welcome. Amen. So let's be welcoming. You know, let's be a community that follows Jesus Christ, that creates space for other people. We should always make room for other people. At our church, we have a space for children. We have a space for youth. We have a space for everyone. We have a space for people who dance. We make space for people who sing. You know, we have Bible studies. We make space and room for people, you know, and that's what it's all about. If you're going to have a community that embraces everyone. And Jesus was all about making room, relating to others in need, because he made room for different kinds of people. And like I said, these were the sinners. These were the folks that were, as some people would say, living foul. Okay. But before we judge people, how many times have you been living foul? Hallelujah. Amen. Foul. F-O-U-L. Foul. Amen. So Jesus made room for different kinds of people. Are you making room for people? Amen. Well, let's take a look at our third point, and that is Jesus' actions drew people who watched his works. Jesus always helped people in need, and when people saw his actions, it drew people, and they watched, you know, the stuff that he would do, because he would just go out and he would try to, you know, do things to assist other people. So in Mark chapter 5, verse 22 through 24, I'm reading in the New Living Translation. The Bible says, then a leader of the local synagogue, whose name was Jairus, arrived. When he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet, pleading fervently with him. My little daughter is dying, he said. Please come and lay your hands on her, heal her so she can live. So Jesus went with them, and all the people followed, crowding him. It's interesting because Jesus's presence always provoked conversations and controversy. You know, the people didn't like him. You know, the leadership, I should say, the religious leadership didn't really like him. They weren't a fan of his, but they saw that people were drawn to him. And so wherever Jesus was, he provoked people talking. He just got people talking. They were talking or talking about him. Because I always tell people, if you're sitting around talking about somebody, then you got that certain somebody on your mind. I remember somebody was, I'd say I was arguing with somebody. I was like, see, I'm all in your mind. You ain't in my mind. See, yes, I am. You still talking about me. Ain't nobody talking about. See, you still talking about me. Whatever. See, you still talking to me. See, I'm all there. See, all there. I'm not saying you do that to anybody, but Jesus, he drew people and they watched his works. And so he went to go help this man and everybody followed him. So it always provoked controversy too. Like, why is he healing? Why is he doing this? Why is he helping that person? Why is he doing that? But the people came to see what was going on and it got people talking. My whole thing is, let's be approachable to people. He drew people. Let's be approachable. Let's not be the type of follower of Jesus. Let's not be the type of Christian that pushes people away. Because I'm so holy. I'm so holy. Look at that. I'm so holy. Oh, I can't. No, let's be the kind of person that's approachable. You know, I remember one time I was when I was a student at Ohio State, the Ohio State University. There's this guy that used to be there preaching. I mean, he told everybody he was going to hell. I mean, everybody was going to hell. And I'm not even saying he was necessarily wrong, because, you know, it was the OSU University. So I'm not saying he was necessarily wrong. So, but I'm walking. One day I said, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and speak to him. Because he would just stand out on this little, you know, he had this little box or whatever he used to stand on. And I came by and I said, he was just, you know, you're repent, you know, be baptized, you know, you're going to hell. And so I said, I forget what his name is, so I don't even want to say it if I knew it now. But I said, well, hey, I said, I just want to say I'm praying for you and that, you know, God would bless your ministry. Well, I mean, you're going to hell. I said, well, actually, I'm not. I said, I'm also a follower of Jesus Christ. I said, I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ. I'm a, nope, you're going to hell. You need to repent because you're going to hell. I was kind of like, no, I'm a brother in the Lord and you're going to hell. Actually, I'm not. I said, I hope that you're not. That's not your hope for me. I said, but as much as you might want me to be going, I'm not going. I'm a follower of Jesus. And I said, you're going to hell. Have a nice day, sir. And I went on to class. What am I trying to say? Be approachable, people. Come on. Be approachable. You know, don't be weird. You know. I remember one time I was traveling with this group and we were all wearing shirts called I Believe. You know, it was really cool. It was a movement that was going on and all the shirts said was I Believe. We all had the same shirt on and we were going to do missions. And there was a guy in my group, you know, he meant well, but he meant well. Let me just put it that way. So there was these ladies there, these businesswomen that were there, and you could tell they were businesswomen, how they were dressed, they had their briefcases and everything, and they were traveling for business. And it was a bunch of us waiting in the airport to catch our plane. And so one of the ladies just leaned over, she says, I'm noticing your shirts, and you know, what are you guys doing? What are you all about? And so I proceeded to tell her, I said, well, hey, and I told her in a way that didn't come off weird. I said, well, hey, we're a church group from Columbus, Ohio. And right now we're going on missions. That means we're going to serve the community. And we were going to serve a particular community in the Southwest portion of the United States. And I said, we're going to be doing activities there and Vacation Bible School and activities reaching out to that community. It gives our students a chance to, be in servant leadership. And she was really intrigued. She said, oh, I think that's great, you know, letting young people serve and things like that. And the person who was with me, they meant well. They were in my group. They meant well. So that person leans over and goes, excuse me, ma'am. She goes, yes. Do you know that God hates religion? So here we were in a conversation discussing, see, we got to be approachable. The lady was like, I'm sorry, I'm very uncomfortable right now and I don't want to talk to you anymore. And she got up and moved to another seat. And I'm just looking at this person, you know, who's another adult with me. I'm just looking at this person like, really, man? I mean, really, person? Really, person? And I'm sitting here like, come on. I mean, I know they meant well. Why did I tell that story? Because we got to learn how to be approachable, guys. Jesus' actions drew people who watched his works and what he did. And he was approachable. He was someone that this person needed help and they felt comfortable enough to approach Jesus for help. Or maybe the person was even desperate and they approached Jesus. What am I trying to say to you? Learn how to be approachable to people. You know, I might get asked questions about my bracelet I wear all the time. As you guys know me, I've been wearing this for years. You know, I've been wearing this on my wrist. And sometimes so someone will ask me, hey, where'd you get that from? Or, hey, I was eating dinner one time and the waitress asked me. So I'm always looking to share and to talk about things, but be approachable. Don't be weird. You know, do you believe in the lab? You know, see, that would just freak me out too. I'm just like, no, don't do that. You know, I mean, be approachable. You know, someday you're going to die and you could go to hell. Okay, so that doesn't make me want to really have a conversation with you. I was just, you know, I remember one time I was at church. This was years ago. I was pastoring in another church. And, you know, I go in the bathroom real quick and there was a brother in there. And I said, hey, man, how you doing? I'm saved, sanctified, spirit filled, the Holy Spirit, Bible thumping, pew jumping, spirit filled, child God. I said, man, I just wanted to know, did you see the game yesterday? I just, you know, is there anything wrong with what he said? Well, no, but let's be approachable, guys. I mean, let's be approachable. I mean, I'm glad your brother was excited. I just wanted to say hi. You know, and so let's be approachable to others. So what we've talked about so far is Jesus relating to people in need. Number one, Jesus asked people to follow him, even people who weren't liked by other people. He also made room for different kinds of people. Everybody didn't have to be the same. He dealt with the people who were up and outers, down and outers. He dealt with people who maybe weren't liked publicly. He dealt with all kinds of people. But number three, he also, his actions drew people to him who watched him help and serve others. And he made it comfortable for people to come to him with their needs and to ask them for what they needed. He was very approachable. The last point I want to make today, when we talk about being a leader in relationships, and that is relating to those in need, is that Jesus appealed to others because he helped others. Jesus appealed to others because he helped people. And it's all, people are always appealing when you're willing to be there and to serve and to help others. And so in Mark chapter 10, verses 51 through 52, it reads as this in the New Living Translation. It says, what do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked. My rabbi, the blind man, said, I want to see. And Jesus said to him, go, your faith has healed you. Instantly the man could see and he followed Jesus down the road. See, Jesus appealed to others because he helped others. See, we appeal to people when we can help people. See, none of us can do everything, but all of us can do something. And your responsibility is to find out what you can do. Well, PC, you know what I'm saying? I'm only 12. I'm only 18. I'm only in 7th to 12th grade. I mean, what do you expect me to do? Well, you can't do everything, but you can do something. See, we all can do something. Find out what your something is. Have you found out what your something is? Are you still searching for your something? If you are, that's all right. If you know what your something is, are you doing it? Are you doing your something? If you don't know what it is, are you trying to find out what your something is? But Jesus appealed to others because he helped others. This man said, I'm blind. Can you help me? And Jesus helped him. And the man followed him. And so people will follow you when you help them. They will. People will want to be around you when you help them. I'm not saying let people freeload off of you. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about doing things for people that they can do for themselves. If I'm walking down the road and somebody says, hey, can you pick up that piece of paper? And they stand there and they look healthy. My first question is there a reason why you can't? Now, if they tell me, hey, my back is broken and I can't pick up the paper, then I'm going to pick up the paper for them. But if they're like, no, I can pick it up. I just don't feel like doing it. Oh, then I ain't doing it. You can let that paper lay there. Obviously, that paper's not important to you. So you good, bruh. I'm not doing it. But see, Jesus appealed to others because he helped others when they needed help. So the question is, what are you doing to help other people? See, like Jesus, let's ask people, you know, let's relate to different types of people and let's do something for people. Let's ask people what their needs are. Sometimes the needs might be emotional. Sometimes the needs might be, you know, financial. Sometimes the needs might be physical. Sometimes the needs might be spiritual. You never know unless you ask. So let's ask people what they need. You know, when people come up for prayer, the first thing I do, if any of you have ever come up for prayer with me, you know, the first thing I do is I lean toward you and I quietly ask, why did you come up here? Because what's it like to start praying for somebody and you didn't ask them what they needed? That's like me walking into a room to get some help and all of a sudden people just start shoving stuff at me. Here, take this, take that. No, just really, here you go. Well, you didn't ask me what I needed. Maybe I didn't need all of this. Maybe I just needed something very simple, or maybe I needed something complex. But number one, let's ask people, you know, what they need. You know, number two, let's relate to different people. Relate to, just because somebody's different, learn how to relate to them. I lived in Japan for over 3 years. This was many years ago. Over 25 years ago, I lived in Japan. And I lived there for over 3 years of my life. And I had to learn how to relate to different types of people because I was a different type of people. You know, and so I went to Japan. It was culture shock. It was way different. Don't get me wrong. I had a great time. But I remember I used to do this work at the orphanage sometimes, and I would have kids playing my hair. Now, of course, I had way more hair than I got now. So maybe I have to show you an old picture, or maybe I'll have them throw up one of my old pictures. Right. But, you know, I used to have one of those high top fades. You know, it used to be a group called Kid and Play. He had like a high top fade. So I had one of those. And sometimes the kids were playing my hair. And it was like, wow, they were playing my hair. Because they never seen kinky hair before. So you just had to learn. I didn't get mad or anything. I just learned how to relate to different types of people. They were just different. Okay. And so they would sound different. But then I realized I sounded different. You know, I'm like, boy, you talk fast. And they were like, yeah, you talk weird too, Big Mac. You know, see, you talk weird too. So you learn how to relate to people. And then you learn, you know, what can you do for people? I always wanted to know, how can I serve someone? How can I help someone? When I get to know people, then here's how I can serve you. Here's how I can come alongside and assist you. I'm not talking about doing things for you that you can do for yourself, but where can I contribute? And as we are all a part of this world community, and as we are a part of this world community representing Jesus Christ, as his ambassadors, as his representatives, guys, you got to find out what it is you can do to help the world around you to be a better place. And so, like Jesus, let's engage and have conversations with people. Yeah, let's learn how to engage without arguing. Sometimes we want to argue and we think that's what it's all about. Yeah, you, because you're going to hell. Oh, thank you. I mean, let's learn how to engage people. You got to learn how to connect with people. Sometimes find a place of common ground. Like when I was in that airport, I wasn't trying to sit here and force feed or push Jesus on someone. I just wanted to talk to the person and, you know, hey, how are you doing? Hey, what do you do for a living? That's how I found out she's a businesswoman on a trip. So we're just sitting there talking, relate to people. And don't have an agenda when you do that either. You know, if you invite somebody to your church and let's say y'all all talking about, I don't know, hey, did you see WandaVision? And hey, yeah, I saw WandaVision, did you? Yeah, so, okay, did you like it? Yeah, it was pretty funny. Yeah, I thought it was funny too. So you wanna go to church with me? come on. Hey, did you try that McRib at McDonald's? Yeah, man, I tried that McRib. I tried it too. It was pretty good, wasn't it? Yeah, it was pretty good. So do you want to go to church with me? See how they come across? Hey, how's your family doing? Hey, they doing fine. Okay, I'm glad to hear that. So do you want to come to church with me? Okay, so let's engage people, but let's do it in a real way. Let's engage people, get to know people, but let's not have hidden agendas, guys. Let's engage people. Let's connect with people. Let's have healthy conversations with people. And the way you do that is really getting to know someone without wanting anything from them, but really get to know someone. Engage and connect. And that doesn't mean that you can't talk about current issues. That doesn't mean you can't even talk about controversial issues. I'm not saying you can't represent your faith in those conversations, but let's do it in a way that's healthy, okay? But engage with people, have conversations with people, okay? And like Jesus, let's be a welcoming community. Let's welcome people, let's open doors. When someone comes to church, they may not understand everything about the church. You know, one time somebody came into church, I mean, take your hat off. I had to tell the person, chill on that, chill. They don't go to church. This is their first time in the church. Guess what? The church walls are not going to fall down because they got their hat on. I'm not saying you don't address it, but come on. Let's be a welcoming community. The first thing you should say is, praise the Lord, it's good to see you. Good morning, how are you? Let's be a welcoming community as followers of Jesus Christ. Let's welcome people into our lives. Let's welcome ourselves into other communities that can represent the Lord Jesus. Let's represent the love of God, the compassion of God, the concern of God that he has for the world around him. And like Jesus, we'll be able to be a multidimensional leader because we believe in healthy, long-term sustaining relationships, okay? And I believe in that, and I believe that you and I can make a difference in the world around us. You can make a difference in your schools, in your communities, in your families, with others. Use your online platforms, not to push forth foolishness, but be able to push forth a message of Jesus Christ, a message of hope, a message of love. Jesus drew people because he truly cared about people. He wasn't fake in his love of people. He's not fake in his love for you. So I just want to give you an encouragement. Be a welcoming community like Jesus was. He welcomed everyone. He welcomed us. He welcomed you. He welcomed me. And I know I'm full of craziness. And Jesus welcomed me to all my faults and all my mistakes. And yet he welcomed me too. So open your heart if you haven't, and allow Jesus in, because he welcomes you to join him. Allow him to join your life today. Well, guys, this finishes up our journey with multidimensional leaders. Join me next time. We'll be continuing our lessons as we look at the different perspectives of Jesus. I pray that you stay faithful and focused on everything that God has for you to do. I just want to pray for you all real quick. I hope that you're navigating through school. Okay, I hope you're navigating through, you know, family and life and everything else. I hope you're navigating through the pandemic, okay? But please, I pray, welcome God into your heart. And then take that love of God and welcome others to share in it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord God, today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the opportunity for us to navigate. Thank you for showing us the example that Jesus had when he loved others and cared for others. And Lord, I pray that we would continue to reach the lost, that we were trained to serve so that we can change the world around us with the love of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord God. And if there's anyone out there today who doesn't know who you are, who doesn't have a relationship with you, then Lord, I pray that they would invite you into their heart today, invite you into their life today. And Lord, I pray that you would just impact them in a tremendous way. We thank you and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Until next time, God bless, guys. Well, praise the Lord, everyone. And thank you for joining us with the message today. If this message has been a blessing to you, or if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to reach out to me through the information that's listed below. And by the way, if you want to stay more connected with NewGen, follow us on our socials or our website that's listed here. Thanks again for joining us. And remember to stay faithful, stay focused, stay safe, and above all, stay Christ-like for life. God bless until I see you. Purpose over pleasure. I ain't got no time for your shenanigans. I'm trying to make it into heaven. I ain't got no time to be playing with sin.